Today in Ambridge, there's one principal breakfast table topic of conversation.
Two fried eggs or one?
Particularly among the leading personalities of the village.
What are you on about, Dallas?
The milk jug and your elbow.
Oh, just a sec.
There's some coffee on the Hoggart.
Heavens, no.
Oh, I'll have to do it myself, then.
Two eggs or one?
Two, please.
Mm-hmm. What are you going to do, Dan?
There's some coffee on the Hoggart.
Oh, my God. That's awful.
I'll make you a cup of tea before I go.
I know you know, you rascal.
Debbie?
Yes, darling?
Where's Mrs. Snell's thornproof? I was just going to take it down to the interfering old... Oh, hello, Mrs. Perkins.
Two fried eggs or one?
Egg? Will you just shout?
I'll make you a cup of tea before I go.
The Archers, an everyday story of country folk. Its theme tune as familiar as the national anthem or the chimes of Big Ben. And in some ways, even more evocative. The serial is now the longest running in the world. It started 50 years ago. BBC Midlands had the job of producing material for farmers, full of worthy, well-meant advice, much of it coming from the Ministry of Agriculture. The problem, then as now, was that farmers tended not to believe a word the Ministry told them. Godfrey Baisley was in charge of agricultural programming.
I wasn't very happy about the kind of programmes I was doing on farming. I was the farming producer. I felt that the only people who could understand them were the people who knew anyway, and the people who ought to be hearing about this couldn't understand they were too technical.
So they came up with a cunning plan to bury the various warnings, instructions and tips inside a drama serial. Nobody here called them soap operas then. Rather in the way you hide a cat's worm pill inside its meaty morsels. The farmers would absorb this good advice almost without realising it.
This farmer from Lincolnshire, a man called Henry Burt, said what we need is a farming Dick Barton.
Dick Barton, special agent.
Hello, Mr. Barton. Ooh. Unfortunately, we haven't time to play games just now.
Some other time, maybe.
I think not, Mr. Barton.
And there was a touch of Dick Barton about some of the early episodes. Here's Tom Forrest grappling with a poacher in 1958.
Why, you, Tom! Don't stop, you warning. Oh. All right, my beauty. Oh, give me that gun.
You swine, you.
Let go of it, blast you.
No. Oh.
Get out, you. Trying to whistle down my throat, are you? Let go of that gun, you fool. I'll give you a right old basting.
And then after about a very short time, about a month or 5 weeks, it was decided that this could have a permanent place. Dick Barton was coming off the air. We could go into their spot.
Since those early days, the programme has changed enormously, while in fundamental ways remaining exactly the same. At the absolute height of its popularity, it had 20 million listeners in the UK alone, more than half as many as EastEnders has viewers now, and it could be heard in different parts of the world 48 times in any 24-hour period. But as it continued to chug along as an advice line for farmers, it also recorded huge amounts of social change in the second half of the 20th century. Not so much the big public historical events, though these often had bit parts, so to speak, but the more subtle changes in social attitudes, speech patterns and everyday life. When The Archers began, few people had a television, and BBC Radio was respected, trusted and even revered, rather like the royal family was then, and in its way, perhaps just as stuffy.
January the 23rd, 1951. Radio news bulletins are to be read by only 8 people instead of 19. The BBC, reverting to a wartime system, wants its home and light programme announcers to become easily recognised. The purpose is to have consistency of pronunciation and performance. No men with dialect voices, and no women, will be among the chosen 8.
Here is the midnight news, and this is Alvar Liddell reading it.
This is the BBC Home and Forces programme. Here's the news.
The BBC Home Service. Here is a special bulletin read by John Snegg.
And even in Ambridge, the men tended to talk like Trevor Howard and the women sounded like Celia Johnson. For example, here's Grace Archer in 1951.
By the way, Phil.
Yeah?
Daddy asked me particularly to tell you to pick up Jane at the ball at 11.
11?
Yes, he wants you to run her and her baggage over to Hollerton Junction. After lunch, if you've time, perhaps you'll show me something about feeding the hens.
Suspiciously RP for a farmer's wife, that. Ambridge was as class-ridden as the rest of the country. The common, demotic voice, apart perhaps from Wilfred Pickles, was rarely heard on the BBC. And though Phil Archer was scarcely a knob, he was conceived as a matinee idol of the time. He was a representative of the bright, young, post-war generation. This was his character profile for when the programme began.
I'm an old cowhand from the Rio Grande, but my legs ain't bowed and my cheeks ain't tan.
Philip Archer had been born in 1928 and had studied at the local farm institute, where he had shown ability in the engineering side of things. He was handsome, in a quiet sort of way, the sort of young man who would dance well, be a fairly good tennis player, and whose scarf might stream out at the back as he rode his motorbike. He was a member of the Young Farmers Club. His religion was Church of England, and he would attend regularly with his mother.
So he was scarcely a rebel without a cause. Norman Painting has played Phil from the start. To most listeners, he is Phil.
I think he was very much a typical young country farmer, you know, with any amount of energy, trouble with his hormones, heart as big as a bucket.
It was a simpler, more innocent age, a few years before the arrival of Elvis Presley and Teddy Boys, when young men took their mothers to church and everyone in the countryside still knew their place.
Hello there, me old pals, me old beauties.
As in the BBC itself, there was a strict hierarchy. Plebs were, well, plebeian, and they usually weren't too bright, especially Walter Gabriel.
They don't put any teams on the coupon as a chap knows anything about, you know.
What do you mean by that, Walter?
Yeah, well, look at last Saturday now. Hmm? The Ambridge team drew with Penny Hassett and Barchester Rovers drew with Abley. Was they on the coupon? Was they be blowed? No fear.
If they weren't using their poor, tired plebeian brains to work out the pools, they were cheating at dominoes down in the bull.
You've got a good enough memory when you're thinking what doms you got stuck up your jacket sleeve.
Oh, there was only one cheat in that game, and it weren't me, Joe Grundy.
What you seeing?
Come on, Dad, put on your coat, let's go home.
No, he wants to know what he's incinerating.
Calm down, it's only a game of dominoes.
He went to the lav more than's healthy.
Now that the lower orders do much less forelock tugging, society has found other ways of putting down the Grundy family, we forget just how patronising the Scripps could seem. The colourful locals, for example, were recruited from Midlands villages, bypassing the Actors' Union equity. George Hart, with his deep Gloucestershire burr, was initially brought in to play Jethro Larkin.
When I started, I did an umpire at a cricket match, the village bobby, and I did the first Tom Forrest, actually, because I remember some of the words. I was teaching some young lad to guddle a trout in the stream.
Boy, then my father did say, that when summer has come, Tom, it's time to make hay.
Another real local, Bob Arnold, a singing butcher's boy from Burford, took over the part of Tom Forrest a few months later and stayed with the programme until his death 49 years later.
Ale, ale, good English ale, served up in pewter, it tells in its own tale.
Tell me, Mr. and Mrs. Forrest, why do you want to foster a child?
Well, to tell you the truth, it's because I got a lot of love for children and felt there must be a child somewhere who'd get some benefit from it instead of it going to waste.
And we're terribly fond of kiddies and not having any of our own. Well...
I see. One lamp, thank you.
Listen to that social worker. You could engrave Waterford crystal with her voice. The present editor, Vanessa Whitburn, sees an enormous change in the way the humble peasantry has been portrayed over the years.
A lot of comedy, if you look at a character like Walter Gabriel, was derived from almost a Shakespearean sense of the rude mechanical, the bottom sort of characterisation. Now, we do still get a lot of comedy from Eddie, Clary, but it can come these days out of high tragedy and a kind of black comedy.
Give us another pint, Clary.
Sometimes, Joe, I wonder why we don't just take what little profit Grange Farm makes and flush it directly down the lap.
Oh, I hate to hear women talking dirty.
Just thought we could cut out the middleman.
Now, do I get my pint or shall I go down the cat and fiddle?
I'll get your pint. Where's Eddie? Not like him to miss a dinner time drink.
I made him go and have a look at that top field.
I wish we had enough money to buy our own combine harvester. Every year it's the same cad, borrow, wait till the end of the queue.
You're a Grundy now, Clary. That's our lot in life.
It weren't much different when I were larking.
Now don't go getting all tearful on me.
I think I'm all cried out. Here's your point, Joe.
Sure.
Things had swung completely the other way by the 1980s when the then editor Liz Rigby brought in gentleman farmer Brian Aldridge as the landowner we could all hate. Liz Rigby gave him plenty of arrogant misbehaviour to conform to a stereotypical idea of the lazy, sneering toff.
My target was Brian Aldridge because I felt he embodied everything that people love to hate about farmers. He's a cereal baron. He's extremely wealthy. At a time when other farmers are struggling, Brian is just laughing all the way to the bank. He has extramarital affairs with people that everybody like Caroline Bone, and he's not very nice to his wife.
Brian Aldridge doesn't come here very often.
I don't like him. He's really slimy.
His money's as good as anyone else's.
I agree with Lucy. He is a bit smooth.
Smooth? He's positively greasy.
It doesn't matter what the man's like. I'm not helping Joe Grundy. I rang him.
Well, I think Joe's right. If Brian Aldridge is diverting the am, he should be stopped.
I thought he was simply begging, just begging to be hated.
No, Mr. Aldridge, it's no good. You can't fool me.
Can't I?
The rest of the village may think of you as a hard-nosed profiteer, but I know otherwise, don't I?
Believe me, Mrs. Snell, I am above all else a hard-nosed profiteer.
Oh, no, you're not.
Oh, yes, he was. And the horrible Horribin family from the council houses were robbing the village shop, and Sharon was naming her baby after an Australian soap star. In this carefully delineated Britain, in which fixed social rules dictated people's lives, farmers' wives had their own well-defined role too. Jill Archer was less dotty than Grace, who died heroically and famously trying to rescue her horse from a blazing barn the night ITV went on the air. One sensed that Jill's hands were always covered in flour, her apron was stitched permanently to the front of her frock, and long before anyone had heard of Joanna Trollope, she spent her life standing guard at the Arga.
You sit down, dear, and I'll make you a cup of tea before I go.
Jill, of course, when she came into the programme, did very little other than make food and cups of tea.
There's some coffee on the Arga.
And she came in as the archetypal mum, the homemaker.
Bought you some biscuits.
Baking. Jill's done quite a lot of baking.
I think I realised quite early on that that was going to be her role.
Orange and walnut. I was making a batch for us anyway. It's a new recipe Mrs. Fletcher gave me.
A classic line is one egg or two, Phil.
Bill Smethers was the programme's editor in the 70s and 80s.
Well, you'd always, at every breakfast scene, would start with Phil coming in from the milking and Jill saying one egg or two as she's standing by the Arga.
Two fried eggs or one?
Eh? Well, I'm on a diet, supposed to be. Reducing, you know, getting a bit too chubby.
Two eggs or one?
Two, please.
Mm. Contrast Jill with her successor as Principal Archer's wife, the Geordie Ruth Archer.
OK.
Hang on a sec. Pass over the sack of nuts. I'll put some in the trough ready for them.
Oh, good idea. There you go. That means dinner time, doesn't it, fellas?
OK, you can let them out.
Right.
She wasn't content to be snuggling lambs near the stove. She wanted to be in there with the silage and worming the sheep.
This is taking your mind off Bill Knowles. I mean, if I hear that name one more time...
You are not the one who gets talked to as if you're a half-wit. You are not the one who gives all the rubbishy jobs to.
Ruth, I'm on your side.
The contrast between these two symbols of farm life, past and present, turned into a clash over a minor incident when Jill went round to the bungalow to let the gas men in and decided to take the opportunity to tidy Ruth's grubby cupboards.
Oh, dear.
Oh, I know she means well, David, but...
What's she done now?
Only taken over completely. Look around you.
Eh? Looks all right to me. It's nice and clean, anyway.
It should be. Your mother's been on her hands and knees with a scrubbing brush all afternoon.
Well, if she wants to do it, why not let her?
Because it's our house, not hers. She's no right to come in here and decide it needs cleaning. It's insulting.
Jill and Ruth used to edge around each other carefully until they got a good relationship because Ruth felt that Jill was critical of her and felt wanting.
I enjoy doing it.
We can do it ourselves, you know.
Don't think it's meant as a criticism, dear. I realise you don't have much time for housework. You're both so busy.
Ruth, Mum has got a point. I mean, if she's got time on her hands...
Oh, no, it's not about that, Jill. I know it probably doesn't come up to your standards.
I didn't say that.
That's what you think, though. I suppose my mother would think we lived in a pigsty too. But it's our pigsty. We got it that way, and we'll sort it out.
I think what Ruth's saying...
It's all right, David. I don't need an interpreter.
They've patched things up now, but the dilemma of which kind of wife to be was summed up in a recent report from the National Farmers Union on the confused roles of women in agriculture.
Women plough a lonely furrow. From the Daily Telegraph, October the 10th, 2000. Women working in agriculture are still seen by the public as plump cake bakers, occupied mainly with childcare and bookkeeping, rather than ploughing or spreading slurry. In a survey for the National Farmers Union, fewer than half of those questioned thought a woman was likely to drive a tractor, and less than a third thought she might plough.
They could be talking about Ruth and Jill, but however old-fashioned she might seem, Jill has changed. She's gone into B&B in order to reflect the straitened times farmers are now going through. And she still has an important function in the whole structure of the show. Here's the actress who plays her, Paddy Green.
When I first joined, my role was, as many women's role was to be a total support and mother. I have a grandmother who used to be very like Jill. But over the years, as women's role has slightly changed, Jill has become more her own person.
Yes, I mean, even Jill now, life is fast, and she is expected to be a lot of things. She also, of course, runs a B&B in the farm, and it gets busy around Easter, around in the summer, with guests, and so she's juggling a lot of things, whereas Jill is growing, Jill is changing, as we all do, because of outside influences.
The portrayal of women in The Archers has always reflected changes in their social role. Some of these are subtle differences of emphasis. Others were important landmarks, such as the arrival of female priests. Interestingly, the women in the series have tended to be stronger characters under woman editors, but the treatment has stuck pretty closely to the changes and debates of the real world. For example, in 1965, the then Miss World, Anne Sidney, came to Ambridge. These days, the Miss World contest is almost accepted in a postmodern, ironic kind of way. But this was even before anyone had accused the contest of being a sexist cattle mart.
After weeks of toil and anxiety, the day of the Ambridge summer fete dawned at last. Philip Archer was up and about very early so that he could be at the airport to meet Miss Anne Sidney, Miss World, who was to open the fete.
I'm sorry, but I really haven't got the time to sign autographs at the moment. I've got an appointment.
I think it's time you were rescued, Miss Sidney. My name's Archer, Philip Archer. I'm here to represent the Fete Committee to meet you and drive you to Ambridge.
Oh, how do you do, Mr. Archer?
Delighted to meet you, Miss Sidney. And I can only say that your photographs don't do you justice.
What an old smoothie chops Phil was. 20 years later, the political climate had changed enough to make that kind of thing rather awkward. Bill Smethurst tried to introduce a storyline about a rural beauty contest.
I can remember sitting at a script meeting when Tony Parkin had got some material for us, wanted to present a story. The Dairy Queen is coming up. Do you want to have somebody entering for it? And I said, well, who wants that story? And whereas normally people were grabbing stories because everybody wanted something to write, suddenly the two girls or the three girls there, no, they weren't saying a word. And we suddenly realised, myself and Tony Parkin and the other male writer, that we'd got three feminist writers sitting there. I hadn't really come across it before. And then the other writer, male writer, James Robson, just said very slow. He was a very slow sort of chap. He said, I'll do it, Bill.
It was in a similar spirit of deliberate mischief that Pat Archer entered the series. She was close to being a caricature of strident feminism.
Now, what about the division of wealth and the division of labour? Now, that really opened my eyes.
What's all this? You're subverting her.
Well, go and find your farming news. Leave us alone.
In the 1970s, feminism was still viewed with suspicion in many places, and those definitely included Ambridge. In 1982, Pat got in with the CND crowd and was desperate to go to Greenham Common. In a world that keeps
on pushing me around, but most of the day it went peacefully. Demonstrators and police chatted together and paper doves were pinned to the perimeter fence. But then, as a police spokesman said, A tiny minority use the majority
to... I think in the past, before I came here, she was laughed at and ridiculed. That was the way in which her views were represented. She was just made to look, you know, the ludicrous sore thumb of Ambridge who stood there chanting feminist slogans and everybody else was getting on with the work. And what I've tried to do with Pat is show her, in the way that so many farmers' wives are, really integrated into her farm and really working on the farm. And you'll find that a very large proportion of the scenes, which include Pat, show her outside working. We don't hear her sprouting all these slogans anymore. We see her taking decisions with Tony. We see her out working on the farm. So I would say I've done quite a lot for the character of Pat.
These days, Pat is in her late 40s and she's mellowed, though there's still a hint of the old passionate rebel.
This is the Pat who, in essence, hasn't changed, the Pat who supported Tommy last year in his direct action over the GM crop, over Brian's GM crop, absolutely stood behind him. But she, like everyone, as she's got older, she's mellowed. She still, I'm sure, reads The Guardian or The Indie. She's still probably a socialist.
Sex, as opposed to sexism, emerged as a continuing theme rather earlier than you might imagine, though it was usually handled as if with long tongs, through the helpful medium of euphemism. Oh, and it took place very privately.
I tell you what was innocent. It wasn't us. It was a large part of the audience.
This is about as risque as they got in the 50s.
You carve.
Oh, all right. There's one thing I like more than a partridge, it's a brace of them.
You know, I think I'll send a couple to Isabel Workman, just as a gesture.
Oh, yes, why not? Oh, best cutlery and glass out on the table too, eh? What are we celebrating?
Nothing. I just thought it would look rather nice.
Well, it does too. Oh, good Lord, and wine.
I went home and raided Daddy's cellar.
Ah, clever girl. Hey, come here a minute.
Well, something wrong?
Absolutely nothing. This is for being a clever girl.
The partridge will get cold.
Yes, well, that's one way of putting it. Compare that with the celebrated shower scene in the year 2000, featuring Sid, Jolene, and the cold tar soap.
Now, what's the matter with this shower?
Still running cold, is it?
Yeah.
Oh, here, let me fix it.
Oh, Jolene, I wish you'd warn me before you do that.
What?
Slipping out of your kimono in that tantalising way.
Oh, I don't want it getting wet. Perhaps I'd better leave this shower running cold, don't I?
After days of mildly fevered speculation, the nation finally got the chance to be appalled by Radio 4's The Archers last night, with the broadcast of the Sex in the Shower episode, featuring Sid Perks, landlord of the Bull, and Jolene Rogers, the Borsetshire bombshell.
Oh, lovely.
Fans of the show had been anticipating a steamy encounter after reports that adulterous landlord Perks would be heard rubbing down seductress Jolene as they discussed their sex romp.
Is that nice or what?
Yeah, of course it's nice.
But yesterday, Julian Brazier, Tory MP for Canterbury, said people still look to the BBC as a bastion of standards. It's very sad.
Turn around and I'll wash your back. Go on, turn around.
All right.
Good boy.
I'm putting your hands on.
No, you're not.
A spokeswoman for the BBC said they had only received a handful of calls about last night's show, and one of them had been complaining that there was not enough huffing and puffing.
Oh, I'd better give you a good scrub down with a loofah then, hadn't I? Just to be on the safe side.
Oh.
Sex is now a much more open topic. I mean, a lot of our youngsters don't only work on innuendo in the programme, although they do enjoy innuendo, but they're explicitly sexual with each other, as you would expect. So The Archers has always had its fair share of sexy scenes because it's in the real world. But the scenes are dealt with in the style and the period of the time.
Somewhere between the partridge getting cold and Jolene running her fingers along Sid's grouting, there's been a radical shift in the programme's attitude to sex. Though you shouldn't think that just because it wasn't dramatised at the time didn't mean that it wasn't happening.
The first words I uttered as Phil were when he'd got his hand down her blouse. I mean, Grace and Phil were heavily snogging.
There's always been plenty of infidelity in Ambridge. Sid's wife, Kathy, had an affair with the village policeman.
Come here, give us a kiss.
Brian Aldridge got it on with Caroline, and in the early days, Christine Archer suspected that her wrong-on husband was having his own bit behind the door.
You belong to me.
You smell...
Eh?
Perfume. It's a perfume I never use.
The telling detail here is her means of detection. How did she know Paul had been up to no good?
You smell a lot nicer than Dawn Kingsley.
That I very much doubt. All I'm wearing is talcum powder, after bath stuff. You know, the sort of thing everybody buys you for Christmas, regardless of what perfume you use.
There's a giveaway. Not many people use talcum powder now. In each episode, it's these small shifts which define the era, rather than the great events. For example, 1962, as well as being a year suffused with talcum powder, was also the year of the Cuban Missile Crisis and the death of Marilyn Monroe. In 1966, one of the scriptwriters, Ted Mason, wrote a memo to the show's only begetter, Godfrey Baisley, pleading for the Archers to be brought up to date and to reflect the real world, which, whether listeners liked it or not, included sex, violence and bad language. He wanted to know how long the show was going to be preserved in a sort of social formaldehyde. Jennifer, for example, was already going off the rails.
Oh, what a fuss and palaver, and all for the sake of bringing together a man and woman in holy wedlock and all that caper.
Oh, come off it. You like dressing up as much as the next one.
Oh, yes, but not like this. I feel like something off a 1915 picture postcard.
Oh, you look very nice, actually, and I'm not kidding. That dress might seem over feminine to you, but it does suit you.
Does it, do you reckon?
Mm, definitely.
Mm, well, I suppose I'd pass in a crowd. Oh, but give me the jeans or a miniskirt every time.
Well, we children of the 60s know what miniskirts implied. And by 1967, premarital sex had joined extramarital sex in Ambridge. Jennifer was pregnant. Perhaps significantly, she turned to her vicar for advice.
Parson has plenty of practice in the art of keeping a secret, you know. Have no fear. So out with it, Jennifer. What have you come to see me about, eh?
I've come to ask you a favour, Vicar.
Oh, yes?
I'm in a terrible mess, and yet it's my own fault. I don't blame anyone, and I'm going to face up to it. But sooner or later, my parents have got to be told, and that's just something I can't bring myself to do. And I wonder, Mr. Reeford, would you tell them? You see,
Yes? And what would you like me to tell them, my dear?
I'm going to have a baby.
At first, Jennifer refused to reveal the name of the father, but when Adam was born, he turned out to have red hair, just like Paddy Redmond, a farmhand. She moved away from the village to escape wagging tongues, not something most single mothers would necessarily feel they had to do today.
You don't get any, unwelcome comments?
No, just one or two raised eyebrows to begin with. Now they've more or less accepted the position. Well, let me put it this way, Dad. I've had far less comment than I'd have had if I'd stayed on here in Ambridge. I don't really care much what people say now. I can take it.
There was also a debate, quite radical for its time, in 1967, the year in which the Abortion Act in this country was passed, about the various options that she might have. The word abortion was never used in the scripts, but Dan talked about they wouldn't want her to contemplate that little bit of foolishness or something foolish, and we all knew what they were talking about. So, in a way, it was quite radical, but much less in your face than the story. When the issues were on the table, people discussed them.
So, in the early 90s, we had Elizabeth's abortion, a storyline which ran parallel to Shuler's IVF treatment.
Now that it's happened...
Well, we'd better not waste any more time. We'll have to do something about it.
Cameron.
It's all right. You can leave it to me. I'll find the best place and book you straight in.
Cameron, what are you saying?
I'm offering to pay for you to have an abortion.
She then had the really kind of searing decision about whether to go for an abortion or not. And we took her through, in some depth actually, the different decisions that she might have to make.
You don't care for me or the baby. You just want to get rid of it. You!
Oh, okay, go on. Call me what you like. But I'm only trying to do what's best for both of us.
You mean what's best for you?
The issue was handled with care, even delicacy, but there was no hiding behind euphemism. Once again, the central figure was Jill, supporting her daughter without condoning what she'd done.
I did the right thing, didn't I, Mum?
It was your decision.
But you'd have done the same, wouldn't you?
Don't ask me that, Elizabeth.
You would, Mum. Say that you would.
Darling, I love you, and I'll always support you. But I'm sorry, I can't say that. I really can't.
Sex and its results have been a theme almost from the beginning, and they've acted as a barometer of changing social pressures. By the early 1990s, both writers and audience were used to the open discussion of these matters, but it wasn't so clear in the 70s, when writers were deeply split about whether Shuler should be allowed to go on the pill.
Huge discussion at the script meeting, when should Shuler go on the pill or not? And in fact, it was Tessa Diamond, the first woman writer on the programme, brought it up, said, we're having Shuler going off with this journalist from the Borchester Echo. They're going off into the cornfields and this, that and the other. We're making it perfectly clear what's happening. And yet we've not mentioned the pill. It's socially irresponsible in this age. And everybody agreed, all right, she'd better go on the pill. Suddenly Tony Parkin spoke up saying, no, he said, I've got a daughter of my own about that age. The message you're sending is terrible. It mustn't happen. I will resign. I will not stay on a programme that does this. So we talked about this and thought about it. There was no way out, seemingly, until we decided, well, all right, we must be responsible to Shuler, so she must go on the pill, but we must also be responsible to the nation as a whole and listeners, so we won't tell them about it. So that was how the situation persisted. The listeners didn't know, Phil and Jill didn't know, Shuler herself didn't really, but she was on the pill.
What a wonderful BBC compromise. The human, as opposed to the animal life cycle, went on behind closed doors. Here's the birth of Tony in 1951.
Hear that? There it is again.
I heard that. I heard.
So there you are. Boy or girl, it's arrived all right.
Is Master Jack there?
Oh, Mrs. P, what's happening? What is it? Is everything all right?
Yes, you can go and see her now and tell her how proud you are of both of them. It's a fine baby boy, 8 pounds.
Well, there was clearly a baby somewhere in the house. But by the 1990s, we were well aware of the National Childbirth Trust, Sheila Kitzinger, and having fathers in at the birth. This is Ruth, emitting a noise familiar to all those who've either had a baby or been there at the time.
Come on, come on, come on, come on. You're doing brilliantly, love. It's all right, it's all right. Do your breathing. Come on, deep breaths, deep breaths. Won't be long. Won't be long now.
David.
Yes, sir.
Will you just shout?
Well, somehow David kept going, though you know he'd have been happier in the cowshed at the time.
Oh, God!
I'll just shut up. I'm saying the wrong thing. I'll just shut up.
People get awfully cross about the Archers. The most loyal listeners are known to write or phone, or these days email, to complain that the programme is too controversial, too far-fetched, too politically correct, too desperate in its attempts to reflect the real world. Take this letter from a disgruntled listener 10 years ago.
Why a loony left vicar? Haven't we had enough to put up with already? Linda Snell, the unspeakable Jennifer and Elizabeth Archer, Tony and Pat and their sodding yoghurt, tableau vivant from the lives of the saintly Grundys? If I wanted a rural edition of Neighbours, I could plaster the TV with cow dung and achieve much the same effect.
You know, when you write The Archers or you're involved in producing The Archers, everyone's got a story to tell you. Everyone says, what you should do is this, what you should do is that. And you pick up influences all over the place. So you come to this table with a kind of a plethora of ideas and thoughts that come right out of the root of what's happening in society.
What kind of insane, warped logic could ever have come up with the idea that people can be entertained by listening to other people moaning on about imaginary real-life problems? I've got quite enough real-life problems of my own, thank you.
I suspect that many listeners would like the programme to avoid social issues, expressed either openly or by implication, because they'd like it to be a place where unwelcome, unsettling change simply doesn't take place. For some listeners, it's a sanctuary from the real world. Sex, suicide, BSE are, to some, as unwelcome as a big-issue salesman would be in the middle of a Bertie Wooster story. But the fact is that the show tackled vital social issues from the beginning, both agricultural and social. Here's the founding editor again, Godfrey Baisley.
We have got a lot of interesting information over, not only to farmers, but to townspeople to know more about the countryside. See, I felt there were so many townspeople with cars and bicycles and what you will, getting their recreation in the countryside, and that we can improve their knowledge about the countryside and their enjoyment of the countryside by hearing little bits. And they go and check in the country to see whether we're right or not. We were always determined right from the very beginning that as far as it was humanly possible, our agricultural and our horticultural material should be accurate.
Mind you, from the beginning, the big stories have always been, so to speak, lurking in the spinney to one side of the village.
In the early days of the programme, they were very much into melodrama. You know, it started only 5 or 6 years after the end of the war. And people were used to stories of violence and daring do. People dying in the village, people being killed, saboteurs. There were spies hiding in the village and then going off on spy secret missions.
June the 7th, 1951. Two British diplomats who served in sensitive posts in the Washington embassy have vanished in circumstances suggesting they may have been undercover Soviet spies. Donald MacLean and Guy Burgess disappeared from London 2 weeks ago.
You had all that sort of thing happening in those early days, which in a way reflected the start of the Cold War, I suppose, and the fact we all assumed spies were about and were going about their business doing these sort of things. Extraordinary stories were mingled with the stories of domestic life in an English farm kitchen.
As well as spies, there were more quotidian rural criminals, if rather fewer than there are today. In 1967, Doris was coshed by a burglar and left for dead at Brookfield, and Nelson Gabriel got involved in a mailbag robbery. As ever, Walter had some trouble grasping what was going on.
Well, it was in the papers.
Was it? You really shouldn't believe everything you read in the papers, you know, Dad.
Yeah, you mean it ain't true? It ain't the same Gloria?
Look, Dad, if you care to visit me, I shall, of course, be delighted to see you. But on one condition.
And what's that, then?
That when you do, we converse on any subject under the sun, except this tiresome mailbag robbery, or whatever the newspapers call it.
Oh.
I find the subject tedious in the extreme. I have no views about it, and no information to impart concerning it.
Some weeks, absolutely nothing went right. During one spell in 1971, there was a plane crash, a train crash, a sexual assault, and a beam in the church fell on Dan's head. The Ambridge horror seemed to have struck. Things did calm down, though there were constant reminders of the outside world. These are the topical inserts, specially recorded passages, which at the last minute are slipped into a show which might have been recorded a whole 6 weeks beforehand. The first of these appeared in 1951, not long after the programme was first on air, and was about Rab Butler's first budget as Chancellor.
Hey up, Phil. What? It's gone six. Switch on the news.
Oh, good gracious, yes.
See what Mr. Butler's done for us, or to us.
The income tax proposal is that the single allowance shall be increased from £110 to £120.
Uh-huh. Oh, milk, meat and flour are all going up in price. I wonder if the farmers are going to get anything out of that increase.
Yeah, I don't know. It won't, I'm afraid. What it will do is make the public realise just what it costs to grow and produce this stuff.
Yeah, that's
well,
true enough.
Never mind. Income tax allowances are up and family allowances have gone from 5 bob to 8 bob, so Jack and Peggy will be pleased about that.
Yeah, and old Walter hasn't got to pay any more for his pipe or his pint, so he'll be pleased about that.
Oh, and now, for goodness sake, let's talk about something else. Phil says Mrs. Carey came back from Yorkshire with your father, Grace.
Sounds as wonderfully dated as one of the party political broadcasts of the time. Getting the balance right between cosy, attractive fantasy on one hand and chilly, less welcome reality on the other has always been a central problem for Archer's editors. Here's Liz Rigby speaking in 1986.
A lot of people tune in for 15 minutes of pure escapism. And my problem as a producer is, do I give them pure escapism? Is that what I want to give people? A village that couldn't possibly exist in the real world, that probably hasn't existed since before the war, at least the 1950s. A village which does not reflect any of the problems that your listeners will be familiar with in rural communities. A village which is just totally isolated in a world of its own. Do I want to do that, or do I want to show real people, real problems, real lives? Well, I opt for the latter, as far as I can, but not all the audience likes that.
Many of the issues which are tackled are capable of angering farmers, as well as listeners sitting in the stripped pine kitchens of Islington or driving back to their barrowed homes near Manchester. Foot and Mouth in the 50s and BSE in the 80s seem fairly tame compared to the feelings aroused by GM crops and organic plots. Here's Bill Smethurst again.
It was difficult in some respects. Tony Parkin had brought in organic farming. He'd got it for Tony and the Archers. He'd go into organic, and it became a dangerous creature that totally ran out of control. in that all the writers would write about organic farming. The London-based writers, the people who really didn't know an awful lot about agriculture, they'd all latch onto organic farming. They could write about that because they understood what it was about.
I thought you were looking at my spring wheat.
Oh, is that what it is?
Oh, have a heart. That's 4 acres of Timo. Well, it will be.
I was watching the rabbits, wishing I had me gun with me.
Not in my wheat.
Nibbling at the little shoots.
Oh, damn. They always go for the quality stuff.
I suppose they prefer organic wheat.
They seem to.
Tony would come in every script meeting and say, I wish I'd never invented it. I wish I'd never brought it in. Do you realise there's only 0.2% of British agriculture is organic? But time has told, of course, it's taken off now. There's still only a tiny proportion is organic, but everybody knows about it.
Similarly, in the 1990s, Life imitated Ambridge with the GM storyline.
Oh, God, I wish it was all over.
Oh, Tommy, can't last much longer now.
Who reckons the summing up could take some time?
It is a very complicated case.
But the jury's got to be on my side, don't you think?
When Tommy Archer trashed baddie Brian Aldridge's GM crop, the attack led to a trial which preempted a similar real-life court case involving Lord Melchett, the director of Greenpeace.
Not guilty. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much indeed for the care and attention you have paid to a difficult and complex case.
And it faced head-on strong dilemmas about the nature of freedom. What a better story for drama than that? It's another man's denial of freedom. And that's a great sort of philosophical conflict.
Life in Ambridge is still a little bit rosier than in real life. One of the placards at a pro-hunting demonstration outside the Commons in 97 read, "This is real life, not the Archers." But many town versus country tensions have been registered on the programme. Take Linda Snell, a towny newcomer who arrived in 1987, fresh from Sunningdale, Berkshire, with very fixed ideas about village life.
Hooey, Mrs. Archer.
Oh, I'm off.
Don't be so rude, Phil.
Mr. Archer, too. Hello.
Hello. Afternoon.
How nice to see people taking the time to talk in the middle of the afternoon.
Well, Phil was just going, actually.
Yes.
Now, what are you off to annihilate with that gun?
Vermin.
Rats?
Pigeons.
Pigeons? Pigeons aren't vermin. Look at all the people who keep pigeons at the bottom of their vegetable garden. Miners. That type of person, I believe.
Those are racing pigeons.
I did introduce Linda Snell with the intention of making her quite a serious conservationist and making her just stand outside the farming community of Ambridge and sometimes praise it, sometimes criticise it, but certainly just for us to see the characters and the things that they did in their everyday life, as just see it all from a different viewpoint. But what I hadn't taken into account is this, what I call the insider factor, which is that many members of the audience like to believe that they are in Ambridge, you know, they're part of Ambridge. They see themselves as villagers, they're characters they've known for years. And they hate outsiders coming into the village.
It's very kind of you to let me look round your conservatory like this, Mrs. Snell.
No, not at all. I think we villagers of urban origins ought to stick together.
Oh, why is that then?
Oh, just a feeling of exclusion in the air.
In Ambridge? Oh, never.
It is very hard to introduce a newcomer to the programme who the audience is not automatically going to dislike.
Linda Snell speaks very highly of you these days.
Give me strength.
And I think, especially somebody who is criticising, say, Phil Archer.
Listeners have often made it clear that they don't want some issues to intrude at all, either because they feel they don't belong in the countryside in the first place, or because they spoil the dream of a happy rural Elysium.
Come and meet Usha. Usha Gupta, my new partner. This is Susan Carter.
Hi, how do you do?
Oh, pleased to meet you.
That was Usha Gupta, an Asian woman who arrived, perhaps risking the appearance of being a token ethnic minority, to join Mark Hebden's solicitor's practice in 1997. Usha suffered a racist attack, but later was allowed to become a character in her own right. Not, though, before another round of Archer's bashing from tradition-minded listeners.
We came from Uganda, you see, Mrs. Carter. You're probably too young to remember Idi Amin.
Oh, no, I do, a bit.
We were very lucky to get any accommodation at all.
The press say, you know, there's no rural racism, etc. And you just know it's wrong. You just know it's wrong from personal experience. I mean, I know a black farmer in the West Country, for example. Some of the press said this sort of thing doesn't happen in the countryside, and the CRE just contradicted it and came up with statistics. and facts and real-life stories. And so it was one of our most successful stories, I think, in recent years.
One of the most important shifts over the last 50 years has been the way listeners have related to the programme and to the BBC. Obviously, we're all much more media savvy these days. We know the actors are all drinking instant coffee in a distinctly unglamorous studio in Birmingham. We know that the sound of the cows being milked is on CD, and that the door of the bull is about 1 foot high and stands on a studio table. But we put all that aside to enjoy the characters and the stories. What on the whole we don't do anymore is knit pullovers for the Grundys or send birthday cards to Jill. Liz Rigby pinpoints the moment when things changed.
I think there is a very hard core of the audience who does still believe that the arches are real, who do send wreaths when somebody dies, cards on a character's birthdays, that sort of thing. I think that audience, well, I would locate the date as 1967 as being the date when that audience began to change. Either that audience then shifted to television or they just became more sophisticated and realised the difference between the drama and reality. And now we have a lot of people who choose to believe in the arches. They know it's not real, but they want to pretend. And they want to pretend quite, quite passionately.
I think people have probably always listened on two levels. Suspended disbelief. They pretend they're believing in it. Although I think it's also true that in the 50s, a lot more people listening to it thought it was a genuine reflection of life or believed what they heard on it. If you've heard it on the BBC, it must be true. We're a lot more cynical nowadays.
Radio 4 has a primarily middle-aged, middle-class, educated audience, and listeners can enjoy the Archers on two levels. I find personally that the friends who joke about it most are always the one who insist on never missing it.
Well, I must be off home to be bed. Good night, Jethro.
Good night then, Mr.
How do you then, Jethro?
Oh, evening, young Eddie.
I didn't like to interrupt. You've been so deep in conversation, like.
Well, I was deep in conversation, but I'm blessed if I know who was.
Oh? Well, surely you knows who that was, Jethro.
Never seen him before in my life. Total stranger he was.
Well, I hope you didn't say anything too saucy, because that was Dan you was talking to.
Dan? The boss?
That's right, the new one. He may not sound much like Dan, but that's who he was, all right.
Another new Dan,
aren't you? Oh, Lord, Jethro, you've gone and done it now. And no mistake.
So they are a family, but what kind? The Archers, the people, as opposed to the Archers, the soap opera, were once seen as an ideal, cosy nuclear family, not unlike the rather drearier Mrs. Dale's Diary, the serial made in BBC London, which the Archers finally saw off in 1969.
I shall always worry about you, Jim.
You could almost smell the homely warmth of Jill's kitchen, the wet clothes drying on the ceiling rack, the sponge cake cooking in the arga.
You know, there's no need for you to get up every morning and get breakfast. I can cope. Hold it. Hang on, Shula. Have a heart this time in the morning.
What's your daddy saying to you, eh? He's an old grumps this morning, isn't he?
Well, I just don't fancy the old spoon and plate obbligato at 7 in the morning. But to get back to the point, I could get breakfast as easy as pie.
I like getting breakfast.
There is this bit of a fantasy in the city dweller's mind about living in the country and about being a farmer, or at least what goes on farms. And I think we probably just supply that little net. It goes back generations, because people came off the land I don't know how many generations ago, and I think we probably just touched that nerve.
The Archer family is probably the envy of many families in real life, because we are witnessing the breakup with the extended family, there's no doubt about that.
When you're lonely, when you're sick, when you're old, it's the family you haven't got, and you become part of it, I suppose.
This we know from our fan mail. People will write you letters, and they still do. This isn't a thing that happened only 20-odd years ago, even though our audience has changed in many ways and they're much more sophisticated. But people will still write you letters and tell you their innermost secrets. And lonely people especially will write to you because you're their relatives and friends, and you're much closer to them in many cases than their own relatives, you know. Never comes to see his mother, you know, the old joke. But we go and see them every day of the week. We never let them down.
These days, Ambridge is a long way from the idyllic place many of us think we can remember. Ruth has struggled bravely with breast cancer. Disease and debt have made farming hazardous and unrewarding. Sid and Kathy's marriage has dissolved in acrimony, and the Grundys are bankrupt. The hammered ferrets episode was particularly painful. Now the Archers themselves are beginning to fall out over who gets the farm. For the Archers has always changed along with its own rural setting, with the country as a whole, and most of all with its audience.
Having listened back to archive stuff of the late 50s and 60s, I get such a strong sense of the period, of the time. I think it works in a way that we can't even analyse, but I have no doubt that people in 20 or 30 years' time, or even further ahead, are going to look back and feel that there is an essential character in the stuff we're broadcasting now. Yeah, I think it's a very good historical document, actually.
Getting very friendly all of a sudden, isn't it?
What nonsense. I think it's very thoughtful of her, and I appreciate it. Well, I must be off anyway, or Flash will be getting chilly. See you at lunch, George. 1 o'clock sharp. But I do mean sharp.
We'd soon have this place the talk of the county.
What, the old bull inn at Ambridge? Never.
I've seen success stories built up out of far less promising material than the bull. We run it quite well, but it doesn't have the touch of class that attracts the big spending tourists.
You mean you'd put special fancy foods on instead of the straightforward English dishes that we put on at the moment?
Always bullying me. You see what happens, Philip? Hmm? Nicest pie before you marry them. Then they chase you around from morning till night.
Well, it's time somebody did.
All right, up you get, my dear.
Thank you. 1 o'clock, George. Don't forget.
Right.
Bye, Philip.
Bye, Mrs. Fairbrother.
What's wrong?
Nothing. You look marvellous. The slacks are smashing and the sweater's just the job.
University, indeed. Who does she think she is?
That'd shake the family rigid, eh? Jack and Peggy's daughter to university.
Hello there, me old pals, me old beauties.
Hello. It's a Ford Capri.
Oh, I love the furry dice.
50 years ago, recovering from a debilitating war and from rationing, we wanted warmth, reassurance, the affirmation of home and community life. We didn't always get it, but perhaps we thought we did.
I think the pace of events in Ambridge has always been the same, really. I mean, the past is safe because it's happened.
Our job, our basic job, is to reflect life as it is in an ordinary country village. As it is. Not as it used to be, not as it might be, not as it ought to be, but as it is.
Now it seems we ask for rather more misery and deprivation in our drama than we once did. If we don't get it, we feel we've been short-changed.
Hey, come on, dear. Sit down.
Why don't you just let me die?
You're not going to die. Sit down there. All right.
Be better if we did.
No, it wouldn't. I'll get you a glass of water.
Better death than dishonour.
But the Archers shows no signs of flagging. And I feel pretty sure that 50 years from now, the pendulum will have swung back as David and Ruth's son Josh dandles his grandchildren on his lap as the kettle whistles and the scones bake in the arger.
It's a strange thing. It's probably something to do with all our memories of everything, really. If we look back, we always blot out nasty things and think of nice things. It is quite true that the Archers, from its very earliest days, certainly in the 50s, there was always trouble and discord and unpleasantness. People have always complained and said, why can't it be like it was? And of course it never really was like it was.
Can I make you a cup of tea before I go?